No, and I can repeat it. And they'll be answering from the table, passing the mic down, and then returning to the podium for their closing remarks. So, if we are ready, I will begin with the opening question. It is on the subject of criminal justice, prison, and healing. Canada's crime rate has been decreasing for years, yet changes to criminal justice policy in the past decade have resulted in more people going to prison for longer periods of time. Many inmates in Canada are serving sentences for a non-violent offense. 76% of prisoners in provincial jails and 33% of those in federal penitentiaries. Many repeat offenders are mentally ill, cognitively challenged, and/or addicted. The questions for candidates are, how then do you and your party propose to make effective use of the resources committed to justice and corrections? How would you and your party develop restorative approaches to justice that support healing for victims, offenders, and communities? How would you prepare and support women and men who are serving sentences to be good neighbors in our communities upon their release? And you have 1 minute.
All of that in 1 minute. So we have a conservative government right now that, in the face of all the evidence and all the experts, has pursued what they call a tough-on-crime policy, which has put, you know, more people in jail, you know, despite the fact that the crime rate's falling. You know, they're putting people in jail for things like, you know, using marijuana, which, as far as I'm concerned, shouldn't even be a criminal offense. You know, so this is... So this is a very poor direction from the Conservatives. The criminal justice system is supposed to do sort of 3 things. Punish people who've committed crimes, deter people from committing crimes, and rehabilitate people who've committed crimes. The Conservatives seem to have put all the emphasis on punishment and forgotten about rehabilitation. That's what we need to rediscover. We also need better social policies to address the causes of crime so that people aren't in contact with the criminal justice system in the first place. Thanks very much.
The next answerer is candidate number 4, which is Louis Brown.
Thanks very much. The Conservatives' done-on-crime agenda is focused on punitive measures and ideological posturing rather than measures to keep Canadians safe. Further, they have wasted millions of Canadian taxpayers' dollars fighting court cases their own lawyers advised them were doomed to fail relating to mandatory minimum sentences. A Liberal government will focus on protecting Canadians and making our communities safer by pursuing evidence-based policies that reduce crime and prevent reoffending. While some criminals no doubt need to be locked up for long periods of time, that should be a last resort, as it is far more expensive to do so. Rehabilitative programs that are proven to limit repeat offenses should be maximized. The Liberal Party of Canada believes that corrections must include an emphasis on rehabilitation and that prison farms taught practical skills and helped prisoners prepare for reintegration into Canadian society. Proper rehabilitation is needed to promote public safety and reduce repeat offending. The prison farm delivered on both counts and should be reopened. Thank you.
Next is number 1, Tamara Friesen.
Thank you. A few years ago, I was facilitating a job-finding club at a regional college in Saskatchewan, and this Aboriginal Student Association put on a professional development for the First Nations students, and it's titled, How to Navigate the Justice System as a First Nations Person. If we want to fix justice, we got to fix racism. And to do that, we need to get to know our neighbors. Once we get to know our neighbors, we can develop empathy and we can develop actions. Some of the green actions is to fully implement the recommendations of the Truth and Reconciliation Commission, to reopen the farms that were shut down and the prison programs to help rehabilitate, to also implement a guaranteed annual income to address poverty, and to stop minimum sentences. How's that?
And we'll now hear from Boyd.
Well, putting people in prison often doesn't serve a purpose. However, if somebody commits heinous crimes like murdering another person or raping, these persons do deserve being punished for their crimes. On the other hand, people who commit crimes, so-called victimless crimes, simply for taking, let's say, a drink or having marijuana, smoke, or other victimless crimes, their place is not in prison. They should be educated, perhaps, and left alone even. Now, so these people have no place in prison. So-called white-collar crimes, like somebody cheats somebody out of money, well, these folks should restore the money to the people that they victimized. As for the people who are with psychiatric illness or addicted, well, they need psychiatric care and help. We need more psychiatrists and maybe not so much prison guards.
We'll now proceed to the next questions. The order for these questions is 2, 4, 3, 1. These questions deal with Canadian mining companies operating abroad. Canada is home to more than half of the world's mining companies. Human rights abuses, including displacement of communities and violation of labor rights, and environmental abuses are increasingly associated with their projects. To the candidates, would you and your party support the creation of an independent extractive sector ombudsman to investigate complaints of human rights and environmental abuses by Canadian companies operating internationally and to make recommendations to companies and to the government? Would you support legislative access to Canadian courts for people who have been seriously harmed by the international operations of Canadian companies? So starting with candidate number 2, you have 1 minute.
So we're talking about mining operations and businesses running abroad, not in Canada, for Canadian companies. Well, Germany, for example, has a law that you cannot bribe people outside of a country that is punishable there. The other countries' businesses complain that it puts them in competitive disadvantage. As for the environment, we actually outsourced a lot of polluting industries to poorer countries, and we are not concerned too much about what happens in those countries. The other question that was about whether you'd recommend access folks to Canadian courts. Canadians also can access courts in the other countries, so they can access the courts, but on the other hand, the laws in Canada should protect mostly the Canadians. And, 2 seconds, thank you very much.
The Liberal Party of Canada shares your concerns and has long been fighting for transparency, accountability, and sustainable in the mining sector. Specifically, Liberal Member of Parliament John McKay advanced Bill C-300, the Responsible Mining Act, which was narrowly defeated in August 2012. According to the Globe and Mail, MP McKay's Bill C-300 would have created a credible, objective forum to promote dispute resolution and help companies avoid and resolve conflict. Canadians like you expect our businesses to reflect our values, and success of Canadian business rests in part on Canada's good reputation. When one company or individual's association associated with a company acts in a way that damages our reputation, it hurts all international Canadian business. Continuing to address these issues and finding meaningful solutions is a priority for us in the Liberal Party of Canada. It is through dialogue with Canadians like you that the Liberal Party of Canada can shape policies that reflect the values of Canadians. Thank you. Merci beaucoup. So I mentioned that I worked for the United Steelworkers Union, which is the largest union of miners in Canada.
And we've been very active in trying to expose some of the misdeeds of Canadian mining companies abroad. First of all, in a spirit of solidarity and concern for the welfare of people in other countries. But second of all, because we don't want a race to the bottom where Canadian mining companies are able to undercut health, safety, environmental, and labor standards in Canadian mines. So it's important for both those reasons. I'm very proud of the fact that our union is quite involved in the campaign for Bill C-300, which Louis mentioned. I'm proud of the fact that all the NDP MPs voted in favor of that private member's bill, which would have done exactly what this question suggests, to make Canadian mining companies legally accountable in Canada for their misdeeds abroad. Thanks very much.
The short answer is, yeah, I would be happy to advocate for those two items a little bit longer. If we're talking about global economy, we need to recognize that we are a global community and then that we further have global responsibility. The Green Party wants to make sure that we do not engage in any more FIPAs, Free Investor Protection Acts. They undermine local sovereignty, ours, and any weaker economies. We want to make sure that any agreements that we enter into uphold the sovereignty of the local governments, our own governments, the local environment, our environment, Indigenous peoples' inherent rights, and consumer protection and labor protection. So we want to encourage a global governance system to help resolve these disputes. And once again, I'd say I'm very pleased to advocate for these 2 points.
Our next questions involve taxes and inequality, and the order is 4-3-2-1. The concentration of wealth and power at the top levels of society, what the Occupy movement called the 1%, is increasing, leading to inequality by many citizens in their ability to participate in our economy and our society. Taxation review may be one tool to counter this trend, since some corporations use existing laws, tax loopholes, and foreign tax havens to avoid paying their fair share of taxes, thus actually paying at a much lower rate than the stated official corporate income tax rate. Questions for candidates. What would you and your party do to reduce tax avoidance and tax evasion and to increase recovery of unpaid corporate taxes from, for example, tax havens? Would you favor a low-rate tax on international financial transactions? And we are beginning with candidate number 4.
For 10 years, Stephen Harper has ignored those at the heart of our economy, the middle class. While doing most of the heavy lifting, middle-class Canadians have had to work longer and harder for an ever-shrinking piece of the pie and less financial security. Canadian families need to have money in their pockets to save, invest, and grow the economy. We want to build an economy that works for the middle class, because when our economy works for the middle class, our country works for everyone. A Liberal government will cut taxes for middle-class Canadians. If your annual income is between $44,700 all the way up to about $215,000, and that includes millions and millions of Canadians, the Liberal Party of Canada, and only the Liberal Party of Canada, will cut your personal income taxes. We will raise taxes on the wealthiest 1% so that we can do this. Across Canada, that's an annual $3 billion economic stimulus, with the delivery mechanism being everyday Canadians. When the middle class is strong and prosperous, we create jobs, support investment, and stimulate growth for all Canadians. Thank you very much. Merci beaucoup.